Wow, have we all been treated to a fantastic exposé today of the wonders of trees and tree planting. We've heard of trees in natural forests, trees in rangelands, trees in cities, trees in mangroves, trees in timber plantations, as natural regenerants in parklands, as commodities, and trees in agricultural lands. We've heard of public forests and private forests, trees for goods and trees for services. Indeed, one of our speakers today, for his PhD studies in Kenya, found 63 uses for trees in farming landscapes. That's staggering. And I challenge anyone in the audience or most experts to name even half of those uses. And that's the point, because no single villager or the communities where he worked would be able to name all of those, but together they could collectively. And so what do we want to do with tree planting alone? And what do we want to do collectively? As the enthusiastic mayor of Freetown inspired us today with her example of Freetown is a tree town. Fantastic slogan. We heard a lot today about numbers, millions, billions, and trillions. And apart from all of these zeros, three was also a significant number. There were three domains, the forest, the plantations, the farms, three groups of main purpose, products, services, and social capital. Three propagule types, natural regenerants, seedlings, and enrichment planting. And that three by three by three gives us 27 combinations for us to consider. And 27 is also a significant number for us today, as we had 27 presentations. And my personal favorite amongst all of these 27 presentations was all of them. They were brilliant. Yes, we had the forest royalty and forest celebrities, including Wanjera Maathai, Thomas Crowther, Yvonne Sawyer, Nicole Schwab, and Robert Nasi. We heard from tree cognoscenti, Sarah Anderson, Vania Olmos-Lau, Harry Lovenstein, Jad Daly, Elizabeth Wathuti, Malito Bande, Lauren Fletcher, and Joyce Ferreira. We were treated to much private sector and private investor reality checks from Tanya Haverman, Bonnie Norman, Caroline Van Tilburg, Howard Shapiro, and Boris Saraba. Really importantly, we also heard from a government forest ministry in the form of Pak Agus Justianto from Indonesia. And please also allow me a personal thank you to the CIFOR-ICRAF and Resilient Landscape staff, including Cora, Howard, Leona, Mohammed Ramney, Roland, and Tor. What's wonderfully balanced about these presenters is that we had 16 female and 11 male speakers, 16 speakers from the global north and 11 speakers from the global south. So where's the greatest opportunity for tree planting, in the global north or the global south? Well, first of all, maybe let's look at the hemispheric north and south. The northern hemisphere has 90% of humans, 90% of people live in the northern hemisphere, but it only has 40% of the land. The southern hemisphere has only 10% of the people, 60% of the land, and 60% of all tropical forest, which is where most deforestation occurs. And the global south is pretty much everything up until 30 degrees latitude north and maybe 50 degrees latitude north in Asia, apart from Japan, Australia, and New Zealand. But it really does not matter where you are in the world, trees and forests both matter. And all these trees and forests in the north and south are at risk of deforestation, degradation, habitat loss, and climate change. And Elizabeth Wathuti also reminded us of the threat of fire. And indeed, the Global Landscape Forum is planning a special event on this burning issue of forest fires in the near future. Now, some fires are good for rejuvenation and restoration, ecological functioning, but also we've seen devastating fires in Australia, in Russia, in Brazil, in Central Africa, and in India, and the United States of America. And many of these fires are triggered by lightning. Now you think that that's a natural process, but with every 1 degree increase in temperature, there's a 10% increase in lightning strike. So therefore, if you increase CO2 in the atmosphere, and then that increases global temperatures, then you increase lightning strikes and hence fires. Therefore, if you emit CO2, you are also an arsonist. Yep, it's true. And maybe somebody should tweet or share on Instagram with Greta Thunberg that slogan, let's shame the arsonists. Now, I'm not sure how many of you noticed the background behind Jad Daly and his presentation today. It was made of a very high-tech nursery with root trainers and raised nursery beds. And it made me smile a little, as when I was a recently graduated forester, I remember visiting a village in Tanzania and lecturing this woman, yes, lecturing, about the benefits of root trainers. And at the end of it, what she said to me was, nonsense. She could not afford the infrastructure or the root trainers, and but didn't want to use as much water as she was. So she said to me, so the main thing you want me to do is to have my seedlings air pruned off the ground. And I listened attentively to her. And then she said, and what about if I dig a hole and put a lattice work of thin bamboo strips across? Will that work? And obviously it was a very humbling experience for me that the global north did not really know best. And of course, I've had the privilege to share that, her wisdom, with others around the world. Much of today focused on scale. How do we plant those billions or trillions of trees? And from a natural regeneration perspective, questions around, well, how many flowers end up as seeds? How many seeds end up as seedlings? How many seedlings end up as trees? And if we want a trillion trees growing and functioning, then we probably need 2 trillion trees planted and 5 trillion tree seeds sown in nurseries. And that's where the bottleneck is going to be, both for natural regeneration, in forests and making sure we have minimum viable populations that are producing those seeds, and in nursery growing planting stock. It was motivating today to hear from the finance folks that tree planting is a potentially attractive enterprise for bankable or indeed, as we reminded, investable projects. And both Tanya and Caroline reminded us of the problems of greenwashing initiatives. And although they didn't use these words, Boris and Bonnie reminded us also to avoid green wishing initiatives, and particularly those that were not backed up by evidence and science. Many speakers reminded us of the importance of social inclusion with women and youth, and the ecologists reminded us of the priority of protecting natural capital and its role in the circular economy. And although bankers, ecologists, and social scientists all like the word equity, it means different things, and we have to ensure that we don't have tree planting initiatives that are lost in translation with such varying interpretations. In one of the videos, Lalisa equated tree nurturing to the nurturing of children. Tree planting alone is like the act of conception. It is not the decades involved in raising a child, and the same is for tree growing. Tanya spoke about the price, cost, and value of carbon and the dangers of equating forests just with carbon. And carbon is the most variable commodity there is in the world. It ranges from $2 a ton for atmospheric carbon up to $100 billion a ton for diamonds. Same element, just a different form. Wow, talk about value add. And Howard's challenge to beat the Sequoia return from investment of a single cell up to 2 × 10^15 cells. Now, I don't like to contradict Howard, but the Sequoia is not the largest nor the oldest living thing. Our planet is. Yes, it's our planet. And much as the sequoia relies on the neighboring plants and the microorganisms and the endophytes and the insects, amphibians, birds, and mammals, our planet relies on all of the species and all of the biomes and all of the biota. Their interactions with each other and the abiotic elements of our world is what is the living organism. And it is trees that provide the best framework to foster those interactions of water, biota, soil, atmosphere, and humans. Now, before COVID, when we used to close conferences like this, we used to say, so once you get back to your hotel and you pack your bags and fly back to your own country, what will you do to follow up? And Vania challenged us that just now as well. But it is a bit different with these kind of digital conferences. So, you know, do I say, so when this event finishes and you go and make a cup of tea or play with the children or do some gardening, what will you do to follow up? So we cannot let this momentum and not let the wisdom that we've learned today fall unheeded and unacted upon. Now, why should tree planting be controversial? It's as simple or as difficult as we want to make it. Planting and nurturing trees can give us can give us instant gratification or appease guilt, but we're not after instant results. We need to learn to be more patient and to get those special things in life, and surely trees are one of the most special things in life. So if we don't want a plastic, glass, concrete, and steel future, then we do need to plant and use trees more. And Thomas Crowther gave us a powerful fourth dimension of the right tree in the right place for the right purpose and for the right times. And lastly, apart from our wonderful speakers and moderators, please allow me to thank all of the folks behind the scenes who planned, developed, and delivered this event: the scientific, the technical, communications, IT, and administrative staff at the Global Landscape Forum, Resilient Landscapes, and CIFOR-ICRAF. And thanks to all of you for being so engaged. With the four platforms of GLF, YouTube, Zoom, and Facebook, we had over 4,700 people listening in. We reached over 3.5 million people on social media. And on Facebook alone, there was over 3,600 engagements. So with that figure of 4,700 people tuning in, that means that each of us has to plant 200 million trees. Go for it. Thanks very much for engaging today.